In this lecture, I am going to talk about energy and power of both the continuous time signal and the discrete time signal. So, as I said, the continuous time signal is denoted by x of t, and the discrete time signal is denoted by x of n, use square bracket. Okay, so far I have discussed a wide variety of signals, and we see that signals may represent a broad variety of phenomena. In many applications, the signals we consider are directly related to physical quantities, capturing power and energy. Energy in a physical system. For example, let's say V of t is the instantaneous voltage across a resistor R, and I of t is a current, instantaneous current flowing through the resistor R. R ohms, and across this resistor the voltage drop is V of t. Maybe I'll draw here. The current flows through this resistor is I of t. Now the instantaneous power is defined as P of t is equal to V of t times I of t. So from Ohm's law, we know that VI equal to I times R equal to V. Therefore, if we replace that, then this is going to be V of times I of times I of t. I can replace by V of t times R. So this is V squared times of t, or it is equal to I square divided by R. Then or I can say I squared of t times R. Now suppose if you want to find out the total energy expended over the time interval, let's say t1 and t2. So you have the time axis, you choose time t is equal to t1 and some other time instant, let's say t is equal to t2. Therefore, your t lies between t1 and t2. Now, you wanted to find out what is the energy in between t1 and t2. So, the total energy, by the way, this is the instantaneous power, P of t. So, from the P of t, let us find out the energy over the interval t1 and t2. So the total energy expended means spent, sorry, not spend, spent over the time interval let's say T1 less than or equal to T less than or equal to T2. Okay, so you integrate over this period because the power is an instantaneous power. So you take that power P of T, integrate T1 to T2 dt. So So what is p of t? P of t is 1 over r times v square of t times dt. Okay, and from this total energy, we can find out the average power, because this power is instantaneous power. But what we want is average power, average power over the duration, let's say t1 and t2. Therefore, average power is equal to over the time interval t1 and t2 is, you first find the energy and divided by the time duration. So t1 to t2 p of t times dt divided by the length of the time interval. So what is the length of the time interval in this picture? This is the length. So the length equal to upper limit minus the lower limit, t2 minus t1. So you divide it by t2 minus t1. So this is the average power over the interval. T1, T2. So this is going to be 1 over T2 minus T1 integral of P of T is 1 over R times V squared of T times dt, and the limit is T1 to T2. So this is the average power, and this one is the energy, total energy expended over the time interval t1 and t2. So the same kind of thing we can extend to discrete time signal also. As I said, discrete time signal is denoted by, within a square bracket like this, x of n. So we will frequently find a convenient notation or convenient notation for a complex signal. Okay, so sometimes we may encounter a complex valued signals. Okay, so in that case we need to find the total energy over the time interval, because energy and power cannot be a complex quantity. Okay, but the signal can be a complex signal. Therefore, whenever you encounter a complex valued signal, then you need to modify the definition slightly. Okay, therefore the total energy over the interval t1 less than or equal to t less than or equal to t2 in a continuous time signal, let's say x of t, is defined as, take the signal, square it and integrate over the range t1 and t2. And one more point I would like to mention here. Suppose in this expression, consider this one. If I substitute r is equal to 1 ohm, then this definition becomes 1 over t2 minus t1 integral of v square of t times dt t1 to t2 or I can say t2 minus t1, t1 to t2, I square of t times dt, because I assumed r equal to 1. So in signals and systems, what we do is mostly we will assume r equal to 1, so that it simplifies the notation and it simplifies our calculation. So for that reason we do that. So therefore this x of t can be a voltage signal or a current signal, it doesn't matter. So in either case, so this is a definition, the definition of the total energy over the interval t1 and t2. Okay, and since I said if the signal is a complex signal, what you do, for if the signal is a complex signal, then take x of t and find the modulus value, that is magnitude of the signal x of t, and then square it and then integrate over the interval t1 and t2. So this definition is used for a complex signal, complex valued signal. Okay, so this is the total energy in the complex signal. Here x of t, and this indicates magnitude operation. Magnitude of the number x. Now the time averaged power is obtained by dividing this energy by its length. Time averaged power is equal to, you take the energy, that is integral of modulus of x of t, square it, and the limit is t1 to t2, and divided by its length. What is the length? The length is t2 minus t1. So this is the time averaged power of a complex signal x of t. Now let us talk about the same thing for a discrete time signal. As I said, the discrete time signal is denoted by x of n like this in a square bracket. Now the discrete time signal exists between the interval from, let's say, n1 and n2. Okay, so in the continuous case you have the signal like this and you integrate from t1 to t2, but in the discrete case the signal values are discrete. Therefore what you need to do is you need to sum them up. Okay, so that's what we are going to do to find the energy of the signal, total energy of the signal in the discrete time domain. Therefore you take x of n and then square it. If it is complex signal, then take magnitude and square it, and the limit ranges from n is equal to n1 to n2. So this is the total energy. Now if you divide the number of points in the interval, then that yields the average power over the interval. So you can count how many points are there in this. Maybe let's say number of points is equal to, I mean here in this one, which is equal to n2 minus n1 plus 1. I'll tell you why this 1 is coming. Okay, for example, you take the signal like this, maybe this also 1 volt and this also 1 volt and this also 1 volt and this also 1 volt, for simplicity. let me take 0, 1, 2, 3 and 4. So how many points are there? There are 4 points. Okay, so what is n2 here? N2 is 4. As per the formula, it is n2 minus n1 plus 1. Right? So what is n2? N2 is equal to 4. N1 is equal to 1. Therefore, 4 minus 1 plus 1 is equal to 4 points. So there are 4 points. Okay? So therefore, in the interval from n1 to n2, how many points are there? N2 minus n1 plus 1. Or sometimes you can argue like maybe the signal is symmetrically located. Let's say this is 1 volt, 2 volt, 3 volt, let's say 0.5 volt, let's say 2 volt, then that's it. This is minus 2, minus 1. This point is 0, 1 and 2. Now, what is the n1 value? N1 equal to minus 2. What is the n2 value? 2. So, number of samples in this interval. Is equal to n2 minus n1 plus 1. What is n2? 2. What is n1? Minus 2. Plus 1. So 2 plus 2 4, 4 plus 1 5 points. Now look at here, this is the first sample point, second one, there is one guy sitting here, third one, fourth one, fifth one. So there are 5 points. So the number of points in the interval n1 to n2 is n2 minus n1 plus 1. Therefore, this is the average energy, total energy. To find the average energy, divide by its length. Therefore, average power is equal to 1 by n2 minus n1 plus 1 times, maybe I'll write down here, power is equal to 1 by n2 minus n1 plus 1 sigma, n is equal to n1 to n2, you take x of n, modulus, take magnitude of that and then square it, that's it. So this is the average power. Furthermore, in many systems, we will be interested in examining power and energy, not over a finite interval. Okay, because here we considered from T1 to T2, and in the discrete case, we considered N1 to N2. But in many cases, we will be interested in calculating the energy and the power over an infinite time interval. Okay, so what is the total energy? From minus infinity to plus infinity. Similarly, in the discrete time domain, we would like to know what is the total energy or power over the interval minus infinity less than n less than plus infinity. Okay, so in these cases, we define the total energy as a limit of the previous definitions. So our definition says, you take 1 by T2 minus T1 integral of T1 to T2, take modulus of that, square it and dt. So in this one you take limit. Take limit. Okay. So let me call this T2 minus T1 as the interval length capital T. So limit. When T goes to infinity, then we would be able to calculate the energy over the infinite interval. Okay, so this energy over the infinite interval is denoted by or defined by like this, E suffix infinity. So it is defined as the same definition, but we are allowing the time interval to go to infinity. Okay, so integral of minus t to plus t, take modulus and then square it and integrate. So this is the definition of total energy over an infinite time interval. Okay, so this is as it is like minus infinity to plus infinity times dt. You can write like that also. Similarly, in the discrete time domain, energy over an infinite interval is limit, let's say capital N goes to infinity, N is equal to, let's say, minus N to plus N, x of N, take modulus and square it. So the same thing I can write as N is equal to minus infinity to plus infinity, x of N, take modulus and square it. So this modulus is needed only when you are dealing with a complex signal. Otherwise, you can simply write down the definition there. The magnitude operation is not necessary. Note that for some signals, the integral, integral or the sum might not converge. Converge means what? It should give a finite value. Sometimes, no, the integral may not give you the finite value. In that case, what will happen? That's what we are going to look at now. For example, you take a signal like this. The signal is constant forever. It goes up to infinity and here also from minus infinity. Let's say the voltage is 1 volt. In this case, what is the energy of the signal? Because the energy is infinite, you are taking over the infinite duration. Okay, so such kind of signals will not give the finite value. Okay, such signals have infinite energy. Okay, so therefore such signals are called not an energy signal. Suppose if the energy over an infinite duration is less than infinity. Less than infinity means what? This indicates finite energy. So if the energy of the signal is finite, then we will call it a finite energy signal. Okay, so in an analogous fashion, we can define the time averaged power over an infinite interval. Time averaged power over an infinite interval. So that is defined as, by the way, I forgot to tell you, this triangle indicates defined as, and here this triangle also indicates defined as. It's a definition, that's all. Okay, so limit t goes to infinity over the interval 2t minus t to plus t, take modulus and dt. So this is the time averaged power over the infinite interval, because I am letting t to go to infinity. Therefore, this indicates time averaged power over an infinite interval. And this power is denoted by p suffix infinity. Okay. And for the discrete time case, p suffix infinity, this is a capital P, capital notation, capital letter, is defined as limit n goes to infinity 1 over 2n plus 1, because one more sample is sitting at the origin, where sigma n is equal to minus n2 plus n, discrete time signal, take modulus and then square it. So this is the average time averaged power over an infinite time interval, and this one is for continuous time case and this formula is for discrete time case. So with these definitions we can identify three important classes of signals. Okay, so the first signal is, the first classification is energy signal, then second classification is power signal, and the third one is neither power nor energy. These are the three important classification. So the first of these is the class of signals with the finite total energy. When I say energy signal, it has finite total energy. If any signal which has finite total energy over an infinite duration, then you call such a, you call those signals as a energy signal. Therefore, when I say finite, then it should be less than infinity, and here this infinity indicates duration. Duration. Such a signal must have zero average power. Okay, so whenever you say a signal is finite energy signal or an energy signal, then the energy the power should be zero. Why? Because we know the relation. P infinity is equal to limit t goes to infinity 1 over 2t integral of minus t to plus t x of t times dt. Now what is this? This is the energy. Energy. Now you can say limit of t goes to infinity 1 over 2t, again limit t goes to infinity minus t to plus t dt. Now this one is e infinity by the definition, please recall. So therefore limit t goes to infinity 1 over 2t e infinity. Now as I said, for a energy signal this is finite, therefore limit t goes to infinity e infinity by 2t. E infinity is a finite quantity, finite value, value divided by this is infinity. So finite value by infinity, which is equal to zero. Therefore the end result is, for a energy signal the power is infinity. Therefore if E infinity is less than infinity, that means finite energy, this implies the power over an infinite interval is zero. Okay, an example of a finite energy signal is a signal that takes on the value 1 for let's say 0 to 1. let's say the signal is like this. This is 0 and this is 1. Oh, one second. This is 0, this is 1, t, x of t. Now you can find out the, you know, energy of the signal. What is the energy? E infinity. E infinity equal to, is equal to 1 over limit t goes to infinity, 1 over 2t, integral of minus t to plus t, x of t times dt. Now what is capital T? As I said, it is a interval. Interval, okay. Now, limit T goes to infinity. Now, the signal exists from 0 to 1. And the interval is, this interval is 1 unit, maybe 1 second or 1 minute or 1 hour. So this is not 2, that is going to be 1. 0 to 1, x square of t, 1 square times dt. Limit t goes to infinity, 1 by 1 is 1, 0 to 1 times dt. This is equal to limit t goes to infinity 1, there is no dependent variable t here, so this is 1. Therefore this is a finite energy signal, because energy is finite. Even if you allow t to go to infinity, capital T to go to infinity, so 1, you put a suitable unit here. What is the unit of energy? You can put joule. Okay, so if E infinity equal to 1, then what is the power? Power equal to 0. You can verify that. Now this is the first class of signal. A second class of signals are those with a finite average power. Whenever a signal has a finite average power, then you call that signal as a power signal or finite power signal. Therefore, the power over an infinite duration must be finite. So that means what? You are finding the power over infinite duration. Infinite duration. And that power is finite. And this meaning indicates finite. And this subscript indicates infinite duration. Please don't confuse with the notations. Okay, so when P infinity is less than infinity, then what about E infinity? That you can, you know, simply find out. Okay, in that case, the energy of the power signal is infinity. You can prove it. It's a straightforward exercise. Therefore, if there is a non-zero average energy per unit time, then integrating or summing this over an infinite time interval and yields an infinite amount of energy. Okay, so for example, you take a constant signal x of n equal to 4 has an infinite energy. Okay, this guy has a infinite energy, but if you find out P infinity, then it is going to be 16. So this is a second classification. This you can, you know, simply you can work it out. It's not a big deal. And then the next one is neither power nor energy. So neither power nor energy. In the previous definition, what I said is a signal is a power signal if E infinity is finite. If it is an energy signal, then energy is finite. But neither power nor energy means E infinity is not finite, and P infinity is not less than infinity. Okay, E infinity is not finite. Then P suffix infinity is also not finite. Then such a signals are called neither power nor energy signal. If you want to take a simple example for this, then you take x of t is equal to t. So the signal looks like this. It goes like this. Maybe my drawing is not very clear. Sorry. So this is x of t equal to t with the slope, let's say 1, and this also 1, slope 1. So this signal is neither an energy signal nor a power signal. So it's simple, you can prove it. Okay, now let me take some examples. Some 2 or 3 examples, with that I'll stop it. Suppose x of t is equal to e power minus 2t, and the signal is defined between 0, infinity and 0 otherwise. So like this, the signal is defined. Now how do you find out the energy E infinity and P infinity? Always you try to find out E infinity, because finding P infinity is very straightforward from E infinity. So E infinity is defined as, by the definition, limit T goes to infinity integral of modulus of x of t, you take square of that, times dt, minus t to plus t. Okay, since the signal does not have any negative part, see, it starts from 0. The minus t is here and plus t is here, so it is 0 from minus t to 0. And the signal is a decaying exponential. This is your e power minus 2t. When t equal to 0, the magnitude is 1. So this is your e to the minus 2t. So this is limit t goes to infinity minus t to 0 dt plus integral of 0 to tt dt. I can write like this. Now anyway, this one now goes to 0. So limit t goes to infinity integral of 0 to t e to the minus 2t, take modulus and square it and then integrate from 0 to t. So it's a simple integration. T goes to infinity, then to t e to the minus, it is a real signal, so there is no need to take a modulus operation, times dt, and integrate and substitute the values. Finally you will end up with 1 over 4. So this is your e infinity. Now look at here, the total energy, is finite. If it is finite, then you can call this signal as a finite energy signal. If you want, let me work on it. So, sorry. Limit t goes to infinity. No, sorry. This is e power minus 4 t over minus 4, and the limit is 0 to t. Then limit t goes to infinity. What is the upper limit? Upper limit is t, therefore e power minus 4 t minus, and the lower limit is e power 0 times anything 0 by minus 4. Now is equal to limit t goes to infinity e power minus 4 capital T minus e power 0 is 1 over minus 4. When limit t goes to infinity, then this becomes e power minus 4 times infinity minus 1 divided by 4. What is this value? E power minus infinity is 0. Therefore, 0 minus 1 divided by minus 4, which is equal to 1 over 4. That's it. So therefore, the energy is 1 over 4. Now, finding power is quite simple. P infinity is equal to limit t goes to infinity 1 over 2 t e infinity. So e infinity is 1 over 4, let's say 0.25, that is, then this is 2 t limit t goes to infinity. So this is 0.25 divided by something very close to infinity. So this becomes 0. Therefore, power infinity equal to 0. Power infinity equal to 0 because it is an energy signal, because energy is finite. Similarly, you can work out many more examples. Let me take one more example in discrete case. So let's say x of n is equal to cos pi n divided by 4. This is a signal. So let me check it first. This is yes, x of n equal to cos pi n by 4. Fine. Now, how do you find the p infinity? Because the question is asked to find out p infinity. P infinity is equal to limit capital N goes to infinity 1 over 2n plus 1, right? Summation of x of n, take modulus and then square it. N is equal to minus n to plus n. So let me substitute limit n goes to infinity 1 over 2n plus 1 summation of n is equal to minus n to plus n. It's a real signal. Cos is a real signal, therefore cos square of pi n by 4. Cos square theta, we know the formula. Cos square theta equal to 1 plus cos 2 theta by 2. So you can use that formula. So this becomes n is equal to minus n2 plus n 1 plus cos of 2 times pi n by 4, that is pi n by 2. So this is becomes limit n goes to infinity 1 over 2n plus 1 summation over n is equal to minus n2 plus n 1 plus limit n goes to infinity 1 over 2n plus 1 n equal to minus n2 plus n cos of pi n by 2. And there is this 2 is there, this 2 will come out like 1 by 2 here. So let me put 1 by 2 here, and here also can put 1 by 2 and like this. Now you are adding 1 between minus n to plus n. So let us concentrate this one. This one is, let's say this is minus n and this is plus n. So the signal strength is 1, like this. Let's say, for example, let's say n equal to minus 5 and this is plus 5. How many samples are there in this? There are 11 samples, right? That means minus 5, 5 minus minus 5 plus 1, that is equal to 11. So that means n minus of minus n plus 1, which is equal to 2n plus 1 samples. So therefore this summation will yield up 2n plus 1, that is 1 square actually, but anyway that 1 will go, sorry, it's 1 only, 2n plus 1. So that summation will yield 2n plus 1. So that is going to be 1 half limit capital N goes to infinity 1 over 2n plus 1 times 2n plus 1. So this and that will get cancelled. So 1 by 2 limit n goes to infinity 1. So this again equal to 1 half. This is the first half. Therefore, this part gives the answer of 1 half. Now let us concentrate on the second part, second half. So this is 1 half. Let me choose some other color. Limit n goes to infinity 1 over 2n plus 1 summation of n is equal to minus n to plus n cos of pi n by 2. Now if you apply some little bit knowledge from your trigonometry, then it's very easy to solve this guy. Okay, so how can we proceed now? We know that the cos function is always oscillates between the finite value. For example, if you take cos omega t, it oscillates like this. So it takes the maximum value of plus 1 and the minimum value of minus 1. So it never exceeds plus 1 or minus 1. Therefore, the maximum value that is taken by this cos pi n by 2 is plus 1, and the minimum value which is taken by this function is minus 1. So what you are doing is you are adding finite value over finite duration. See, this is minus n and this is plus n. In between you are adding some finite values. Maybe it changes, it goes like this. So adding finite values over finite durations, and what will you get? You will get finite value. So therefore the entire summation yields some finite value. Okay, therefore this is a trick actually that we need to use here. So 1 over half 1 sorry 1 half limit n goes to infinity 1 over 2n plus 1 times some finite value. We don't bother what that value is. Anyway, we are not going to use it since we have 1 over 2n plus 1 in the denominator. So no need to find out the exact value. Okay, so you have some finite value in the numerator. Now let us allow this n to go to infinity. 1 over 2, 1 over infinity times finite value. Now finite value by infinity, this is going to be 0. So therefore the second half becomes 0. Now the total value is going to be 1 half plus 0. So it is equal to 1 half. So please remember this. Therefore the power of a discrete cosine waveform is 1/2 watts. So this is very very important result, we should always remember. Suppose instead of x of n, let me take a times cos of some pi n by 4, then what is the power of the signal? Then p infinity is equal to a square by 2. You can verify that. Similarly, if I take a continuous time case, x of t is equal to a times cos of some omega t, then what is the power of this signal? It's very simple, you can find out. So in this case, power of this one is defined as limit t goes to infinity 1/2 t integral minus t to plus t. It is a real signal, I don't want to take modulus. Let me put x squared of t times dt. Now first to find out this guy. So integral of minus t to plus t, maybe I'll write down here, plus t cos square omega t t times dt. This is minus t to plus t cos square theta, 1 plus cos 2 of 2 omega t times dt, and 1/2 will come outside. I'm sorry, this is a, right? So a squared, and here a squared. So a squared over 2 minus t2 plus t dt plus a squared over 2 integral of minus t2 plus t cos of 2 omega t times dt. Okay, so the first one is this one, if you integrate, then a squared over 2 times 2t. And what about this one? A squared over cos omega 2 omega t. If you integrate, you'll get a sin 2 omega t divided by 2 omega, and the limit is minus t to plus t. So therefore, a squared over 2, this 2 and this 2 will get cancelled, a square t plus a square over 2 times 2 times 2, it is 4 omega. Then sine of 2 omega t minus sine of 2 omega t minus. Okay, so minus into minus plus. So this is a square over t plus a square over 4 omega times sine of 2 times sine omega. Sorry, 2 omega t. 2 omega t. And that anyway, this 2 and this 2 will get cancelled. So a squared t plus a squared by 2 omega sine of 2 omega t. Now, what else is left? Okay, so that's it. So this is the final thing. So take this guy and plug it in the formula. A square t plus a square by 2 omega sine 2 omega t. So by definition, limit t goes to infinity 1/2 t a square t plus a square over 2 omega sine 2 omega t. Okay, now you take this limit inside. So limit t goes to infinity, t and t will get cancelled, a square over 2 plus limit t goes to infinity a square over 2 omega sine of 2 omega t. Now this is a constant, so you can pull out of the limit a square over 2 plus this one, you can substitute t equal to infinity here. So a square over 2 omega sine of 2 omega, this t becomes infinity. Now one can ask a question, what is sine of infinity? Because it is after all an argument, then argument can take anything and you take modulus of 360. Finally you end up a value, finite value. Suppose somebody says 720 degree, then take modulus, it becomes 0 degree, right? Suppose somebody says 740 degree, then it is equal to 20 degree. So whatever you put sine, that is some angle, right? Sine of 20 degree is equal to sine of 380 degree or sine of 780 degrees, right? So even if substitute some infinity, then it is going to again give plus or its value always lies between plus or minus 1. Right? So this is going to be always give some finite value. Then one more point I missed out here. Wait a minute. Limit t goes to infinity, then sine of 2 omega infinity. That's it. Sorry. This is t. Now a square over 2 plus a square over 2 omega, then so this is some finite value, okay? So that finite value, let us assume, you know, plus 1 or minus 1. That's it. And one more point I forgot to mention here. What is that? Something is missing here. This 1 by 2t, I'm sorry. This 1 by 2t is missing here. Okay, I'm sorry. I thought of writing here, but I kept on missing that one. 1 by 2t sine of this one. So here also limit 1 over 2t. Limit t goes to infinity 1 over 2t. Maybe I'll do. It becomes messy. So 1 minute. Just hold on. Because limit t goes to infinity 1 over 2t, because the 2t is coming here, this one, sine of 2 omega t. Now this one is a square by 2 omega limit t goes to infinity 1 over 2t, again limit t goes to infinity sine of 2 omega t. Now this is going to be, as I said, finite value. Finite value. So therefore, a square by 2 omega limit t goes to infinity 1 over 2 t times finite value. So when t goes to infinity, then what happens? A square by 2 plus a square by 2 omega times finite value by infinity. Finite value by infinity becomes 0. Therefore, this is a square by 2 plus 0. So a square by 2. Therefore, p infinity is equal to a square by 2. That's all. So if we have x of t is equal to a square of cos omega t, then power in that signal is, a. A times cos omega t, then power is a square by 2. If we have x of t is equal to cos omega t, where a equal to 1 in this case, then p infinity equal to 1 half. If x of t is equal to 4 times cos omega t, then p infinity is equal to 4 square, 16 over 2, which is 8. Don't forget to put the unit, okay? Unit you should write. Suppose if x of t is equal to 2 times cos t, where omega equal to 1 in this case, then also it is 2 square, that is 4 by 2, which is 2. And one more thing, this power is independent of the frequency. So this is the frequency, omega is the angular frequency. So an important point is, power is independent of the frequency. Independent of the frequency, that you should note. So finally, I'll take one more example. With that, I'll conclude this lecture. I'll take one gate question. This is 2001 ECE, Electronics and Communication Engineering. So let me write down the question. If a signal denoted by f of t has energy E. They did not say what is the amount of energy, they simply said E. The question is, the energy of the signal f of 2t is equal to, I think this is not the appropriate place to discuss this problem. Anyway, just since I started, let me finish this. So in the next lecture, I will talk about various operations of the signals, like transformations of the independent variable, like scaling, shifting, then folding, all those things we will see. That time this becomes very easy. Equal to option A, E, option B, E over 2, option C, 2 times E, option D, 4E. Okay, we know the formula. E is equal to limit t goes to infinity minus t to plus t, x squared of t times dt. Okay, now what you do is you substitute the x of t. X of t is nothing but f of t. So in this case, this is the energy of the signal. Limit t goes to infinity to t plus t, f square of t times dt. Okay, now what we want is, we want to find out energy of f of 2t. So f of 2t is equal to, again, same formula, limit t goes to infinity minus t to plus t, f square of 2t times dt. Now you change the variable, let's say 2t is equal to tau, then 2 times dt is equal to d tau. So dt is equal to d tau by 2. So this becomes limit t goes to infinity minus t to plus t f square of tau dt becomes d tau by 2. You can take that 1 or 2 commonly outside. Limit t goes to infinity minus t to plus t f square of tau into d tau. After all, this tau is a dummy variable. Once you integrate, the dummy variable will disappear. So whether you put tau or t or whatever it is, it's not going to affect my integration. Therefore, again, this whole thing is equal to E as per the definition here. Look at here. So this is going to be E equal to limit t goes to infinity minus t to plus t f square of t dt. The same thing here also. Compare, maybe let me call this equation number 1. Then this equation number 1 and this is equation number 2. Compare 1 and 2. 1 is here. Then 2 is here, both are same. So therefore 1 over 2 times E. So 1 or 2 times E means E by 2. So the correct option is B option. So this is, I think, one more question in 2001. So this is a dummy variable. Maybe you can think like, suppose you have x square of, let's say, x into dx, and the limit is, let's say, 0 to t. What is the integration of this? This is going to be x square over 2. The limit is 0 to 2, that is 4 by 2 minus 0, that is, this is 2. Similarly, t square into dt, 0 to t. This also again, sorry, t. This is equal to t square by 2, the limit is 0 to t, which is again, it is 2. Therefore, the final value is independent of what the variables are. Therefore, these are called dummy variables. So therefore, this integral is equal to this integral. Here I used the variable as x, and here I used t. So you just replace x by t. That means you are not changing the integration. Okay, the integral value will be the same. It is not going to change. That is why either you write f square of tau into d tau, or limit t goes to infinity minus t to t f square of t times dt. It is not going to be changed, because after all, this t is a dummy variable. In the integration, this also dummy variable, therefore it is not going to affect your final result. What it matters is this limit is very important. If you change the limit, then this integration, that integration will be different, this one and that one. Of course, if I put here 3, then what will happen? 0 to 3 t into dt, and this will not be equal to that one. In this case, it will give 9 by 2, but in this case it is only 2, so that you should be very careful. Okay, so with this point, let me stop. So before that, let me summarize this lecture. So in this lecture, we have seen energy of the signal and power of the signal. Energy in the sense total energy of the signal, and then we went on to average energy and average power, and we calculated the formula also. We found average power and the total energy of the signal for both continuous time case and discrete time case, and again we classified into three types: an energy signal, a power signal, and neither energy nor power signal. So these are the three important classifications, and the formulas are, of course, you remember. e suffix infinitive. As I said, this suffix indicates the duration over which you are finding the energy. So when I put e suffix infinitive, that indicates the energy over an infinite duration. Okay, the meaning of this symbol is energy over an infinite duration. So the formula is limit t goes to infinity integral of, if the signal is complex, then you take modulus and dt, otherwise no need to take it. And p infinity is equal to limit t goes to infinity 1 over 2 times e infinity, or I cannot say, or you can write minus t 2 plus t x of t, square it, take modulus and square it, and dt, that's it. The same analogous formulas applicable for discrete time system also, dt systems. So the formula is going to be e suffix infinity is equal to limit capital N goes to infinity. Instead of integral symbol, I am going to use summation here. N is equal to minus N to plus N. You take x of N and then take modulus of that and then square it. Power equal to limit N goes to infinity 1 over 2N plus 1. Sigma n is equal to minus n to plus n x of n, that's it. So I think this is a good point to stop. In the next lecture, I'm going to talk about transformations of the independent variable. Okay, thank you very much.